Well, good morning. It is an honor for me to introduce Professor Uli Gross-Niklaus. Uli obtained his PhD working in Drosophila development in the Developmental Biology and Genetics Biozentrum of the University of Basel, under the supervision of Professor Walter Gehring. Later, he switched to working with plants as an independent group leader and then as a senior staff investigator at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory in New York. Currently, Uli is a professor of plant developmental biology at the Institute of Plant Biology in the University of Zurich, Switzerland. His research focuses on the elucidation of the genetic basis and the molecular mechanisms underlying embryo sac development and fertilization, apomixis, and the maternal control of early embryogenesis in plants. In the last two decades, he produced an amazing amount of work, which represented a singular advance in our understanding of plant reproduction. So, Uli, thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to listen to your talk. And we are very glad to have you here and hope you're enjoying your stay in Argentina.
Thank you very much, Silvina, for your nice words. It is a great pleasure for me to be here. I traveled in Argentina as a young lad, backpacking through the country about 25 years ago, and since then I haven't been here, so it's wonderful to see how things changed and how things stayed the same at the same time. Now, when I listened yesterday to the opening lecture of the Congress, I made the decision to change my talk. And rather than talk specifically about fertilization in plants, which is rather specific to the topic that my lab works on, I decided to tell you about the drama that involves sex, parental conflict, and also infanticide. And I think that this topic will be of a broader interest also to people who work in the animal field or even in the medical field, because genomic imprinting does play an important role in various human diseases. And as you hopefully will see in this lecture, many of the mechanisms that control imprinting in plants and in mammals are rather similar. So what I decided to do is to give you a brief introduction into plant reproduction, which is the main topic that my laboratory works on. And then I will in particularly introduce the Medea mutant, which is a mutant we found some 17, 18 years ago that opened our way to study imprinting in plants. It was the first maternal effect mutant that was found in plants, and as you will see, this is because the gene is regulated by imprinting. I will briefly talk about a theory that can explain genomic imprinting both in mammals and plants, and then in the last part, I talk about some more recent results that address specifically the molecular mechanisms of genomic imprinting. Now, to understand plant reproduction, I have to introduce the life cycle of plants, which differs quite a bit from that of animals, in that we have an extended haploid phase of the life cycle. So after meiosis produces the meiotic products, in this case the spores, these do not develop directly into the gametes as they do in animals, where the meiotic products differentiate into sperm and egg. But rather in plants, we have several mitotic divisions that then form multicellular gametophytes, the gamete-producing organisms. And in flowering plants, these are very reduced, and they consist of only three cells for the male gametophyte, or the pollen, that contains the two sperm cells, and only seven cells typically in a mature female gametophyte, which also contains two gametes that get fertilized during double fertilization. And then fertilization brings the two gametes together and reconstitutes the diploid phase, and then we have germination, plant growth, and flowering that will bring us back to meiosis that occurs in the reproductive organs of the flower. So if you look a little bit closer into an ovule, and here in blue you see the embryo sac or the female gametophyte. This is a schematic of it. There's two cells that are important or central to the course of reproduction. One is the egg cell, which will get fertilized by one sperm and then form the embryo. So that embryo will have a maternal genome and a paternal genome and is diploid. The central cell, on the other hand, is the second female gamete, and it contains two nuclei from the mother. It gets fertilized by a sperm cell, and it will form the endosperm, the nourishing tissue that supports the growth of the embryo, and which also, of course, supports our well-being and nourishment. Seeds, and the main component being endosperm in many seeds, supplies about 80 to 90% of our calories, either directly through food or through feed for animals. Now, the endosperm is triploid and has two maternal and one paternal genomes. And when you look at this schematic, it's quite obvious that there's multiple ways that the mother could influence the growing progeny, or the fertilization products, the embryo and the endosperm. The embryo sac is surrounded by sporophytic tissues, schematized in brown. And of course, these tissues could send signals and will also provide nutrients from the mother plant. So this could influence the development of the seed. And we know that this happens now, for instance, through production of hormones in the seed coat. But it could also be that the gametes themselves carry specific information that is required for seed development later on. And this could be like in Drosophila, for instance, where the mother puts a lot of material into the egg cell, proteins and RNA, that is used later on for the development of the organism. And this could happen, of course, also in plant gametes. And a second possibility is that the genomes differ, the epigenomes of the sperm and the central cell or the egg cell, and that this difference will influence how seeds develop later on. Now, we think both types of maternal effects exist. There are maternal effects of cytoplasmic nature, material stored in the cytoplasm of the female gametes, but there's also maternal effects of chromosomal nature, meaning that the chromosomes, the genomes of the two parents, are not equivalent. And that will be the focus of my presentation today. And we started to work on this by the isolation of a maternal effect mutant. What you see here is a seed pod that was opened of Arabidopsis thaliana, our model system. And you see that half of the seeds are white or brown. And these seeds started developing normally. They initiated seed development after fertilization, but then they aborted sometime after fertilization occurred. Whereas the green seeds here, they develop normally and they don't abort. Now, it turns out that these aborting seeds are all derived from a mutant gametes. So if the egg cell and the central cell were mutant, they carried this mutant allele, the seeds will die irrespective of what the father contributes. However, if the female gametes were wild type for this gene, which we named Medea, it will develop normally irrespective of the father's contribution. And it's obvious that this seed here, which dies, and this seed here, which survives, are genetically absolutely identical with respect to the embryo genome. They differ with respect to the embryo genome in respect to dosage. So this is a very interesting mutation that shows a phenotype dependent on which parent the mutation was inherited from. And because in this case, the mutant mother kills her own children, we named it Medea after a Greek mythological figure who also killed her own children. Now, there are many reasons why you could have a maternal effect, one being that there are cytoplasmically stored products, or there are dosage effects that play a role during endosperm development, but it turned out that this gene shows such a maternal effect because it's regulated by imprinting. And we heard yesterday in the opening lecture a little bit about imprinting, which describes an epigenetic phenomenon where the expression of an allele depends on its parental origin. So the absolute identical allele, if it is inherited from the mother, for instance, it may be active, but if the very same sequence is inherited from the father, the gene may be inactive. And this phenomenon was discovered first by Jerry Carmichael in corn when he crossed particular alleles of the R locus, the red aleurone locus. He found that if this is inherited from the mother, you get fully colored kernels. But if the very same allele is inherited from the father, you get these mottled kernels. And he could exclude other causes for this maternal effect and concluded that the differential expression of R is according to the sexual origin. And the chromosomes that are inherited from the father are not identical to the ones of the mother. In epigenetic terms, genetically they are identical. So this can be interpreted as shown here, that in most cells, these yellow cells here, the maternal allele only will be active, whereas the paternal allele is inactive, and if this maternal allele is mutant, we don't have any function, and thus no color. Now, imprinting was also discovered in mice about 15 years later by Azim Surani and Tavor Salter, when they did nuclear transplantation experiments, where they took a fertilized egg of the mouse, removed the paternal pronucleus, and could contribute a second maternal pronucleus in one experiment or two paternal nuclei in the other. And they could show that these mice who have only maternal genomes or who have only paternal genomes are not viable. So the maternal and paternal genomes are not equivalent because there are some genes in mouse, maybe 200 or so, that are imprinted. And the activity of this gene depends on whether it is inherited from the father or from the mother. Now, Medea is indeed an imprinted gene, and that's just two examples of an experiment to illustrate this. What you see here is in situ hybridization to the Medea gene, and you look at two nuclei in the endosperm. So these nuclei are triploid, but what you see here, these dark dots, these are nascent transcripts that are made freshly in the nucleus, and you can see that even so this nucleus is triploid, only two of the Medea copies are active. So you have two dots where you have nascent RNA that's made at this time during development. Also here in this nucleus, you have only two of the three Medea genes, Medea alleles that are active. So this can be interpreted by the maternal ones being active, the paternal one being inactive. Now we can also show this by making a reporter gene fusion to a Gus gene, where we use the Medea promoter, fuse it to Gus. If we introduce this reporter gene through the female, we have nice expression in the endosperm and in the embryo here. If we introduce the very same construct through the father, we have no expression whatsoever. So the Medea gene is clearly regulated by genomic imprinting. The activity of this gene depends on which parent it was inherited from. Even so, the very same sequence is inherited. So this is a typical, a very classical example for an epigenetic phenomenon, where the same allele can have two completely different outcomes, depending on the epigenetic state. Now, I've told you that imprinting evolved in plants as well as in mammals. And it's quite curious that we find this in these two very distinct groups of organisms. And in both, it seems to have evolved rather late during evolution. So in the mammals, you find imprinting in eutherians and also in marsupials, but it's absent from monotremes, for instance, and its absence from birds or fishes. And in plants, even so that hasn't been addressed very carefully, we think it is typical for seed plants. Now, people have wondered why we find such an interesting phenomena in these very disparate groups of organisms. And one of the common features they have in their reproductive cycle is that they share a placental habit. So in both cases, the fetus or the plant embryo develops residing on the mother plant or on the mother, in the mother, and it will acquire resources and need resources from the mother to fully develop. So the mother provides all the nutrients post-fertilization to the developing offspring, whereas the father doesn't contribute anything. Now, of course, in this situation, when the developing next generation is still attached to the mother, that means that the offspring can influence the mother. So there's going to be a mother-offspring conflict, and this can be formulated even a bit more drastically. The offspring, within the offspring, you have a difference of the maternal genome's interest and the paternal genome's interest. And this is described as the parental conflict theory for evolution of imprinting, which is a special case of a mother-offspring conflict that was first developed by David Hake and Mark Westoby many years ago. And they based their hypothesis originally on experiments that have been described in plants, but later on they were strongly supported also by findings in the mouse. So the hypothesis says that if you have a polygamous reproductive system and you have organisms that have a placental habit, you will expect that imprinting evolves as a consequence of a conflict between maternal and paternal interests over how much nutrients the mother will give to the offspring. Now you can imagine that the parental genome would like to cause the mother to provide as many resources to his embryo, to itself, as possible, because different siblings will have different fathers in a polygamous organism, either within the same litter or in successive litters. Now, for the mother, of course, that's not true. She will be equally related to everyone, to all her offspring over her entire lifespan, and she will try to balance the resources between offspring and herself, but also between all the offsprings among each other. So the prediction of this would be that if you have a gene that can control growth, the growth of the fetus, the growth of the seed, that it will become imprinted over time, and it makes a very clear prediction in what direction. If you have a gene that's paternally expressed, the function of this gene would be to increase the offspring size. Whereas if you have a gene that's maternally expressed, it became silenced on the paternal side, it is expected to restrict growth, to equalize growth of all the progeny. Now, there's many examples that support this theory, or at least are consistent with this theory, when it comes to growth-regulating genes. To my knowledge so far, there has been no exception to that. But of course, not all imprinted genes in mammals nor in plants are actually regulating growth. But the ones who do, they show the phenotypes that we expect. So here you see the phenotype of the Medea mutation. This is a wild-type hard-stage embryo that is derived from a Medea mutant egg. Medea is a maternally expressed gene, as I have shown you, and if that gene is lacking, we get embryonic overgrowth. So the function of this gene is to restrict growth. If we remove the gene, we have excessive cell proliferation, and we get giant embryos at the comparable stage. Of course, it takes these embryos a bit longer to grow, because they can only make a certain number of divisions in a time unit. Now, here is an example from the mouse. This concerns an insulin-like growth factor, which is paternally expressed. And if this growth factor is mutated in the mouse, then the pups will be much smaller, about 40% less weight at birth. So as predicted, a paternally expressed gene should promote growth. If that activity is missing through mutation, we get smaller pups. And you can extend this even to human diseases. So here, for instance, we have the cluster, an imprinting cluster in the mouse and in humans that has this insulin-like growth factor 2 and a non-coding RNA H19. They are about 100 kilobases apart from each other on the same chromosome. And H19 is only expressed from the maternal copy, whereas IGF-2 is only expressed from the paternal copy. So in a Norman mouse, a Norman human being, you have one active copy of H19, one active copy of IGF-2, and normal development. Now, in a very simplified way, there are imprinting disorders that can arise through many different ways that will lead basically to having two maternal versions, more or less, of this cluster, so that you have two active H19 genes and, very generalized speaking, no active IGF-2. And these children are severely retarded in growth, have many other problems, but you can see that their stature is very, very small. So the growth effects that we saw in the mouse are also true in humans. Here is the opposite phenotype, where we have two active IGF-2 growth factors, and these babies have overgrowth symptoms, most prominently seen in the tongue, which grows to a giant size. Again, these have many other related problems, but with respect to growth, also these human diseases do fit this parental conflict theory. Now, I've told you about how Medea is regulated, and that imprinting, at least for the genes we were covering here, plays a role in growth control and may have evolved because of this. Now, it turned out that Medea itself is a highly conserved gene. It's a conserved gene between humans, flies, and plants, and it encodes enhancer of cyst-like histone methyltransferase. So this is part of a polycomp complex, which is leading to the methylation of target genes and represses these genes. So these polycomp group complexes, which you find in Drosophila, but also in human, as well as in plants, are highly similar. The four core subunits are all conserved, Medea being the core subunit that has enzymatic function as a histone 3 lysine 27 trimethylase. It's well known from many studies in the mouse, in Drosophila, and in other systems that this polycomb repressive complex 2 plays an important role to keep, for instance, stably differentiated cells, but it also plays a role itself in imprinting, both in plants and in mammals. Now, what is interesting is that whereas two well-studied genetic models, Drosophila and Senoraptitis elegans, have only one copy of this histone methyltransferase, humans and mouse have two, and Arabidopsis has even three. And this gave us a possibility to look a little bit into the evolution of these three genes and see whether we can get more supportive evidence for the genomic conflict theory. If you look at the three copies in the Arabidopsis genome, it's quite obvious if you look at the neighborhood here that Swinger, which is one of these histone methyltransferases, and Medea arose through duplication. There's a block of 20, 30 genes that has been duplicated, and this duplication occurred between 35 and 85 million years ago. Whereas curly leaf, the third member of this small family, is more ancient, it's the ancestral type. And then Swinger and Medea arose in a duplication and are paralogous genes. Now this opens up the possibility to look at the question of how imprinting may have evolved, because Swinger is not an imprinted gene and doesn't play a role in the regulation of growth during seed development. It has such a role before seed development, before fertilization. And Medea, on the other hand, plays a role during growth regulation after fertilization and is imprinted. So this opens, gives us the opportunity to look at these two genes and see whether we can find signatures of selection that would be at least consistent with the parental conflict theory. And I don't want to go into details of this study. This was published a number of years ago. But basically, we did molecular evolution studies that are based on codon models and asked whether Medea was under selection. And we found very clear, if you look at these different homologs of Medea, here are the two swinger homologs from Arabidopsis lyrata, the closest relative of Arabidopsis thaliana, and from Arabidopsis thaliana, we see that Medea, after it was duplicated in this segmental duplication, was under very strong selection. We have here a very long branch, and clearly the ancestral Medea gene before Lyrata and Thaliana split, that branch has strong support for positive selection. Now, if we look a bit more carefully, we see that within the species Arabidopsis thaliana, there's really no difference between swinger, which is not imprinted, and thaliana, which is imprinted with respect to these branch lengths here. So to understand a bit more of the evolutionary pressures that happen within thaliana, we used population genetic studies, and we looked at intraspecific variation of 25 accessions in thaliana, as well as 20 accessions in Lyrata and Haleri, which can interbreed with Lyrata, and are two very close relatives of Arabidopsis thaliana. And we were then asking whether using various statistical tests based on polymorphisms in these genes, whether we could find evidence for selective sweeps or positive selection within the species. Now, clearly there is no difference from neutral evolution in Thaliana, but there is weak evidence for selection in Arabidopsis lyrata. And this is very interesting to us because Arabidopsis lyrata is an outcrosser and therefore will very often have multiple paternity for its progeny, whereas Arabidopsis thaliana is a selfer. And in a selfer, you do not expect a parental conflict because father and mother are genetically the same. They're the same individual. So it looks like we had, after Medea arose in this duplication event, there was a strong selection for it, which is consistent with it acquiring a new function, but also, and or, that it was under evolving under a genomic conflict. But once it became selfing, this conflict is gone, and we don't find any evidence anymore of selection, whereas in the outcrossing species, where there is still a conflict, we still see this evidence for selection. So we think that this is at least consistent with the prediction of the parental conflict hypothesis, and that for the few genes in plants, it's really only two presently that we have phenotype, the two imprinted genes we know a phenotype. They are fully consistent at the moment with the parental conflict theory. So in the last, in the second part of my talk, I would now like to switch to the mechanisms of genomic imprinting and look a bit more in detail how this works at the molecular level. And again, there are amazing similarities between what happens in mammals and what happens in plants. Even so, imprinting, of course, evolved independently in these two lineages. Yet it shares many of the molecular mechanisms that regulate it. So this is a very interesting example of convergent evolution. Now, in mammals, studies in many, many laboratories have shown that DNA methylation is very, very tightly associated with imprinted loci. So usually one of the two alleles carries a methylation imprint that's already established in the germline, so either in the egg or in the sperm. So here is an example where you have methylation in the egg, here methylation in the sperm during spermatogenesis or oogenesis. And then when the gametes fuse, you have differentially methylated genes that will eventually result in differential expression. Now, in addition to these differences in methylation, there are also differences in histone modifications. So usually the silent genes are associated with silent chromatin marks, the active genes are associated with active chromatin marks, and these go together. Now in plants, again, DNA methylation was found to be important for imprinting, as well as histone modifications. Although here, people have only looked at histone methylation at histone 3 lysine 27, that is mediated exactly by the MEDEA BRC2 complex. So here is a model that's based on studies from many different labs, mostly from Bob Fisher's and Fred Berger's group, and also ours, which summarizes how we think imprinting is controlled in plants. And what you see in this schematic here is a simple regulation by DNA methylation that is true for the two imprinted genes, FIS2 and FWA. And it seems like in the diploid somatic cells of the plant, you have both copies methylated. So you have a methylation mark on the parental copy, a methylation mark on the maternal copy. Now, during male gametogenesis, this methylation mark is maintained on the paternal copy, but on the maternal copy, during female reproductive development, DNA methylation is removed actively by a DNA demethylase, Demeter, that can remove a methylated cytosine from the DNA. And then you result in an unmethylated copy and the methylated copy that come together in the fertilization products. The unmethylated one is active, the methylated one is inactive, leading to imprinted differential expression. Now this can become more complicated if, in addition to differences in DNA methylation, which distinguish the maternal and the paternal allele here, you also have different a function of the polycomb repressive complex. So here is the case of MEDEA. Again, through work in many laboratories that has shown that there are methylated regions upstream of the gene and downstream of the gene. And these methyl groups or methylated cytosines are removed during female gametogenesis. So we have an unmethylated MEDEA copy that comes from the female gametes, but we have a methylated MEDEA copy that comes from the male gametes. But later on, once MEDEA is expressed, it forms this polycomb repressive complex, and you need that complex to keep the paternal copy in a silent state. So it's not just DNA methylation that is different between the two alleles, but if you simply remove DNA methylation, the MEDEA gene from the paternal copy doesn't become active. It is repressed by this polycomb repressive complex. So this polycomb repressive complex also plays a role in imprinting in mammals. And in plant, there it has been shown to repress paternally silent alleles of at least 5 imprinted loci. In plants, it can affect either paternal alleles and repress them or maternal alleles and repress them. And how the complex can distinguish between the maternal and the paternal copy is unknown. But obviously, these alleles must carry some mark. Here is proposed DNA methylation, but maybe it's something else that is the imprint, the mark that distinguishes them, that can be recognized by this complex. So that only one of the two alleles, in this case it would be only the paternal allele, is silenced by the polycomb complex. Whereas the maternal allele that's present in the very same nucleus is not. So in this more complicated case, which is true for MEDEA and another paternally expressed imprinted gene that we discovered, FERS1, DNA methylation and FIS-PRC2, this polycomb group repression, seem to play a role. At least this is the model that you will read in many, many reviews. Now, there's a few open questions regarding this. Already several years ago, we investigated how different Arabidopsis accessions, different natural isolates, are imprinted. And we found that some of these accessions that didn't carry these regions that are methylated upstream of the gene, or didn't carry the regions, the repeats downstream of the gene that are methylated, they were still imprinted, which puts the role of these methylation marks into question. This is even clearer if you look at this transgene, which carries only a tiny bit of this, of this helitron here. These repeats are not present. Most of this repeat is not present, and yet this gene is fully imprinted. So in this construct, we only have these two minor methylated regions, which are not even methylated in all different accessions. So this questions whether these imprinting marks, these methylation marks, that are considered to make the difference between the paternal and the maternal allele, are really responsible for this difference. And to address this, a student in the group, Heike Wurmann, was doing a deletion series of the promoter to define exactly the region that is required for genomic imprinting. So she asked, what minimal bit of the promoter do I need to still get fully imprinted expression? So she defined what we call the imprinting control region of MEDEA, or the ICR. Now, she did several experiments with these various deletions. First, she took the promoter and fused it to the MEDEA cDNA and asked, is this construct still fully functional? Can it rescue the mutant phenotype if we provide the construct under this, the cDNA under these promoters? And the answer is yes, all of these constructs can rescue the phenotype, except the shortest here with only 150 base pairs. So 200 base pairs of the promoter are fully sufficient to rescue the phenotype. So this is a fully functional transgene. She also fused these promoters to a reporter gene, beta-glucuronidase or GAS, and then asked, do I get the normal expression pattern that I would expect? And for all of these, except the shortest one, the gene was expressed as we would expect in the embryo and endosperm of the developing seed. And finally, she asked, are these still imprinted? So she used these constructs either as a male parent or a female parent, crossed them reciprocally to wild type, and you can see that these small promoter fragments show expression in endosperm and embryo if inherited from the mother, but they show no expression if inherited from the father. So Heike could conclude that only 200 base pairs are required to get a fully functional MEDEA transgene that is normally imprinted. Now these 200 base pairs are very short. If we go back here, it's just a tiny bit here, and do not contain any of the reported methyl sites, methylation sites. So it seems that methylation is not really required. So we wanted to test this further, and we asked whether these short promoters are still responsive to the enzyme Demeter that removes DNA methylation and is proposed to activate the maternal copy by removing these DNA methylation marks upstream and downstream of the gene. And you can see that if what was published here by Bob Fisher's group, if you have a long fragment of 4.2 kilobases that includes a big part of this repeat upstream, this helitron, then indeed expression of this transgene depends on a demethylase. You have to remove these methylated sites on the repeats to activate the maternal copy. But if you have a short fragment that lacks these helitrons, actually it's fully active without Demeter. So in a Demeter mutant, you still have full activity. You don't need to remove any DNA methylation to activate it, because there is none. Now, I've told you that not only methylation, that is replaced by DNA methyltransferase and removed by this DNA glycosylase Demeter is important, but also PRC2. These are the two or the three known transacting factors of imprinting implants. And they are the key for our current models. Now, and I've shown you this before, if you have transgenes, we can recreate the normal imprinting pattern. But if we remove PRC2, which is done here, we can reactivate a normally silenced paternal allele. So here we cross the reporter gene into wild type from the father, and it's silent. And here we crossed it into a Medea mutant. So this polycomp group complex is lacking, and then it becomes activated. So with the reporter gene, we see this effect. However, if we look at the endogenous genes, but in a quantitative way, rather than just with the reporter gene, we actually see a reactivation. You can see here is a wild type or a MET mutant where we don't see reactivation. If we remove the polycomp complex, we get reactivation. But if you remove both DNA methylation and the polycomp complex, there is no difference. There is no further derepression. So this gray and the black bar are almost the same through 4 days of CT development. Now what is very, so we don't have a big effect by removing DNA methylation on top of removing the polycomp group complex. That's the conclusion of this experiment. Now what is really important is if you look at the scales here. Because if you look at the maternal allele in a quantitative assay and compare it to the paternal allele, you see that this is only about 1% of the expression level. So yes, we get the reactivation, and we can see that very nicely with the Gas transgene, but quantitatively, these reactivated copies make only 1% of the transcripts we see from the female. So by all definitions, this is still an imprinted locus, because 99% of the message come from the maternal copy and only 1% from the paternal copy. Also, it's now visible and detectable. It's still an imprinted locus, which basically means that our two main regulators of imprinting, DNA methylation, as well as the polycomb repressive complex, can be removed, and we still have imprinting. And that then leaves the question, so who is actually making the imprint? Since the known factors are not making the imprint. So to bring all these data together into a model that reconciliates the published data with our new data, we came up with a model where we believe that DNA methylation and demethylation is important to regulate higher order chromatin structure, but the imprint itself is set by something else than DNA methylation or the polycomp repressive complex. So here is a model shown for the central cell where we have two copies of the maternal genome. We think that if these repeats upstream of the Medea gene are methylated, they will aggregate with something and form DNA loops. And these DNA loops or chromatin loops, they are in a closed conformation so that the imprinting factors that should activate Medea have no access. And the same would be true in the sperm where this is methylated, and so this will be in a silent higher order chromatin conformation. Now in the during female reproduction, we have this enzyme that will remove the DNA methylation from the repeats, and after it removed that, the loops are opened, and now the imprinting factors have access to these genes and can set the imprint that will later on make these two copies active copies. Now this demethylase is missing on the sperm side, so these loops are not opened on the sperm side, and as I've shown you before, after fertilization, we need additional factors to repress this gene because DNA methylation and the Polycom complex itself are not enough to keep it repressed. There's other factors here shown in R that are required to be repressed. So currently we really do not know what these factors are that set the imprints to make the active and the inactive, the maternal and the paternal copy different. Now if what I have told you is correct, then these imprints may be set at or just around fertilization, and at least for Medea, the region that makes the gene imprint, it shouldn't have any DNA methylation. Now the problem with these assays I've shown you before is that they are done 7-8 days after fertilization, when the seed is large enough to isolate embryo and endosperm to look at DNA methylation. But nobody till now has looked in the gametes themselves. So we have isolated thousands of female gametes of central cells by laser capturing to then do DNA methylation assays of them. And we have isolated sperm in a biochemical purification to look at DNA methylation in the sperm. And what you see here is FWA, which is a well-established gene that's regulated by DNA methylation. And we expect that for FWA, we have a high level of DNA methylation in the sperm, but it's known that later on in the endosperm, all this methylation is gone. So to our big surprise, in the female gamete, this methylation is still present, which means that the difference is not made before fertilization, as everyone assumed, including us, but actually the difference is made post-fertilization. Or in other words, the difference in DNA methylation cannot be the primary imprint, because DNA methylation does not differ between the female and the male gamete. There has to be another mark that makes them different. And of course, for Medea, there is no DNA methylation whatsoever, neither in the female gamete nor in the sperm cell. So again, here very clearly, the mark has to be something else but DNA methylation. Now, if it's not DNA methylation, then what could it be? That's, of course, something that we will investigate in the coming years. We don't know. But the fact that DNA methylation can change after fertilization is not new. This has been found for two genes in maize. These are two examples, one from Jose Gutierrez Marcos lab and one from Stefan Scholten's lab. And here, when you look at the central cells of the female gamete, the male gamete, the sperm cell, we have no methylation in this gene, in the promoter region of this gene. But after fertilization, when we distinguish maternal and paternal alleles, you see that the paternal allele selectively gained methylation. So this happened after fertilization. And the same is true here for a gene that's imprinted in the embryo, but in the opposite direction. So it seems that for these two examples in maize where people actually looked at the gametes, the methylation status in the gametes, and later on during seed development, as well as for the two examples that we now have looked at in Arabidopsis, that the difference isn't established by DNA methylation before fertilization, but it's established later on, which means that the imprint is not a methylation imprint. So how do we go about to find the real regulators of imprinting? This is an ongoing genetic screen that is being performed by Michi Reisig in the laboratory. And basically, we start with our short promoter fragment that drives the reporter gene. We mutagenize these lines, and we look for second site mutations that lead to the activation, that fail to activate the maternal allele. And we look for mutations that de-repress the normally silent paternal allele. And this screen is obviously very laborious, since you have to dissect these seeds, stain them, look at them at the microscope. But Michi has been successful in finding both types of mutants. So here, for instance, you have a wild-type situation where in every seed, the maternal allele is activated. And here we have a mutant situation where in half the seeds, the maternal allele fails to activate. These are half the seeds that carry a mutant gametophyte, whereas the other half carries a wild-type gametophyte. And here is a paternal repressor. So normally, in a wild-type, all the seeds have a repressed paternal allele. In this mutant, the paternal allele is reactivated. The fact that this particular mutant here also has a problem in seed development and has a phenotype, of course, makes us very positive that we here do indeed have a new regulator of genomic imprinting. So I hope I could show you that by using a model plant like Arabidopsis, we can actually learn something about mechanisms of imprinting that transcend plant biology and that can teach us something about how imprinting may have evolved in a very general way between plants and animals, but it also can teach us something about the mechanisms of imprinting. Because what I haven't told you yet is that it also seems that in mammals, methylation is not always the primary imprint. So far, people who study imprinting in mammals have focused on the mouse. In the mouse, without a single exception, all imprints are established in the germline before fertilization. However, when you go to organisms a bit closer to humans, for instance, the macaque, then you find that of 10 methylation imprints that have been analyzed, only about half are established in the germline. And the other half are acquired post-fertilization, just as I've shown here for plants. So this may, again, be a rather generally applicable system, and it's quite possible that, like the other regulators that were shared between plants and mammals, that also the new ones that we find will have a common role. Because this phenomenon that DNA methylation is only set post-fertilization and that this needs the interpretation of another imprinting mark that was put on these chromosomes seems to be a common one. So to summarize, I've shown you that the Medea locus is regulated by genomic imprinting and it encodes this evolutionary conserved subunit of a polycomb repressive complex. The phenotype of Medea and the molecular evolution studies that we did some years ago, they are consistent with the parental conflict theory of imprinting, as are essentially all mouse mutants that have been looked at if they affect the growth regulating gene. There are mechanistic similarities between imprinting in mammals and plants. So this is a nice example of convergent evolution where both mammals and plants have used the same regulatory modules to regulate imprinting. And these modules are often ancient, like DNA methyltransferases or polycomb repressive complexes. I've shown you in the second part that was more focused on current research that genomic imprinting of Medea transgenes is independent of the two main regulators that place and remove DNA methylation marks. So there's no methylation at the imprinting controlled element. And that we believe that methylation is mainly targeting repeats and transposons in the flanks and thereby controls higher order chromatin structure, but does not directly control the imprinting status of the gene. And the mechanism that makes the two alleles imprinted is unknown. So we can conclude from this that methylation is not the primary imprint. There have to be other imprints on these chromosomes that can be interpreted post-fertilization. And this seems to be also the case for mammals. With the examples that I've mentioned from Anne Ferguson-Smith's group on the macaque that are about to be published. They have been reported at conferences but are not yet available online. So with that, I would like to thank the people who are working on this subject for now more than 15 years. The work that I have presented today was mostly the work of Heike Wörmann, who did the deletion analysis of the promoter and defined the ICR element, Wendelin Wernle, who isolated about 10,000 central cells to do methylation sequencing in the female gametes. Michi Reisig, who is working on the genetic screen to identify new regulators, and Anja Schmidt, who helped also in the characterization of the role of DNA methylation and polycomb repression. Finally, I would like to mention a close collaboration with Jörn Walter, who works on imprinting in the mouse and established a lot of the methylation analysis tools for small cells or difficult tissues, and in particular to Julia Arand in his lab, who helped us with the methylation analysis of sperm and female gametes. And with this, I would like to close and thank you very much for your attention.
Well, we'll have time for a few questions, so.
If we consider the parent-offspring conflict in humans, we can understand it in, say, physiological terms between the mother and the child. But for Arabidopsis, which has a very different structure, it's difficult to imagine how these kinds of conflict are maintained in evolutionary terms. Would you elaborate on that?
Yeah, so I have maybe gone a bit quickly over this, but in Arabidopsis, which is a self-fertilizing plant, you do not find any evidence anymore for positive selection on the locus. Because there is no conflict, it's self-fertilizing, you have lost the parental conflict. But if you go to the closest relative, Arabidopsis lyrata, which separated maybe 3 to 5 million years ago, we still find positive selection. So it looks like from our analysis that before the two split, when they were outcrossing and had various mates, there was a strong selection for that. There was a conflict that drove selection. And once Arabidopsis became selfing, this disappeared. So we don't see in population genetic data, polymorphism data, there's no, within Arabidopsis thaliana, there's no sign of selection. But in Arabidopsis lyrata, there is. So the imprinting is maintained, yes. Because if we change that now, we obviously have a problem in seed development. If you mutate that gene, it is lethal. So you cannot change that anymore.
Yeah. How many genes are thought to be regulated by imprinting in Arabidopsis? And a second question is, if it is known, which are the targets of Medea?
Mm-hmm. Okay, the first question, we know a few targets of Medea that we have studied ourselves. And interestingly, one of them is imprinted itself. And that is Ferres. It is imprinted the other way around. There's a couple others that have been studied, but not many. There's really only three bona fide targets of Medea: FUS3, Ferres, and Medea itself, where people have shown that Medea binds to these sequences. There are many other candidates that haven't been analyzed. Now, the number of imprinted genes, that is a bit a difficult question. Now, if you define imprinting as being differential expression of the same, of two alleles in the same nucleus, that has only been proven for a handful of genes, maybe half a dozen. But if you want to consider candidates for imprinting, where if you analyze RNA populations in developing seeds without knowing whether they were stored in the egg or made after fertilization, then there is hundreds. So there's hundreds of candidate genes. There have been at least three, four studies looking at this, just by RNA-seq, using a cross between two varieties, and then look at polymorphisms. And there is you know, in each case, 100 to 200 were identified. Amazingly, the samples almost, or the candidates don't overlap between the different studies. So I'm not, or very, very little. So I'm not really sure what that means.
Do you see any relationship of the imprinting with the maintenance of the plant size, for example, plant size or organism size? Could we use that technologically, for example, to increase plant size?
Yes. So I think there, of course, the one case we studied, and we only, as I said, have a phenotype for two known imprinted genes in Arabidopsis. They both regulate size. And you can manipulate it such that you can make the embryo bigger. If you, for instance, change the imprinting a bit at the beginning of seed development, you can get the bigger seed. The plants will be bigger, not in our hands, but we haven't really looked at that in great detail. But certainly the seed size we can manipulate.
Here. You found that this short piece of DNA upstream of the media locus is important for imprinting. And you found it because you discovered an ecotype that had lost methylation and still had imprinting. So is there any nucleotide variation in that short piece of sequence between those lines? And the second question is that short piece upstream of the media locus conserved in the paralogous copies that you showed before?
So it is not well conserved in the paralogous copy, which is not imprinted, but it's very well conserved in the autologs in different accessions. That was done a while ago. We should redo it now that much more sequence information is available from different accessions. Initially, we looked maybe at 20 or so in this region. That was quite a while ago. But you know, we defined this region by deletion studies, not by that it was by difference in accession. We just could show that these two known methylated regions are not present in all accessions, but the imprinting is still there. So this was a bit, this was purely at the genetic level, and now we have it down to the molecular level.
Is it transcribed?
This region doesn't seem to be transcribed, no. And it's a very strange, it's probably the most AT-rich region of the genome. There are a few Cs, a few CGs, but it's very AT-rich. And what is quite interesting, these 200-300 candidate genes I mentioned, if we ask, do we find similarity of this sequence in these candidates, then it is almost significantly enriched compared to a permutation test. But it's 0.051, so it's just not. But it seems that at least elements or motifs of that region are present in other candidates, more than you would expect.
Well, Uli, thank you very much for your wonderful talk. Now, on behalf of the... on behalf of the ALAG organizing committee, I will offer you a present. I hope you will
thank
enjoy
you.
It.
Thank you very much.
And it will help you to remember Argentina. Okay. Please stay just a minute. I have to make an announcement. Thank you. Well, I am very happy to announce that our proposal to host the IPMB Congress, International Plant Molecular Biology Congress, in the border of Argentina and Brazil was accepted finally. So in 2015, we will have this wonderful Congress in Foz de Iguazu. We organized the South American Committee, integrated by people from Argentina and Brazil. It's a binational organization committee. But we also included people from Colombia, Peru, and Chile. And we are trying to make a more participative international committee. We are under the auspices of the Argentine National Council of Scientific and Technical Research, the Argentine Ministry of Sciences, Technology and Innovation, the National Institute of Agricultural Technology of Argentina, the Brazilian Research Council, the CAPES, and the Sao Paulo Research Foundation. And we were supported by several scientific societies of the region. So in this Congress, the following activities were planned: 8 to 10 plenary lectures, 54 symposia, between 400 and 700 contributed papers, 4 tutorials and workshops especially oriented to PhD and postdocs, and 1 after dinner speaker. So save the date of the Congress is from the 15th to the 30th of October of 2015. And the venue will be the Bourbon Cataratas Convention Resort in Foz de Iguazu. So we invite you to contribute your papers, and we hope to see you in Foz de Iguazu in 2015.
So much.